Okay. But anyway, I think the beginning is not so relevant for recording. In fact, when Thibaut asked me to give talk here, I was not even sure last week what I'm going to do, and actually I made the reduction of my wave function only yesterday afternoon. Okay, and we'll give so-called blah-blah-blah talk with the level of mathematical rigorous below anything, but it will be related, in fact, with the main topic of workshop, if I understood it correctly, with interpretation of quantum mechanics. But let me start with sky, because there was comment that there are no experimental proofs of quantum gravity. It's of course wrong, because cosmology, what it did right now, it gave us experimental proof of quantum gravity, real quantum gravity. When New York Times was writing that BICEP really was the first proof of quantum gravity, it's again wrong, okay, in spite of the fact that New York Times, no, New York Times, in fact, write not always right things. Okay, let's be diplomatically correct. Because if BICEP finding would be correct, it would prove that 2 degrees of freedom of gravitational field are really quantized. Just actually this transverse degree of freedom. But quantization of longitudinal degree of freedom, which is induced by the matter, was proved in numerous CMB experiments, because prediction of quantum cosmological perturbation theory happened to be in excellent agreement with what people found on the sky. And because these people who were looking on the sky, they had no idea, okay, what they are expected to find, then we can trust them 100%. And not only because of that, okay, there are thousands of people who are involved there. So now, how is this kind of finding raise question related with interpretation of quantum mechanics? If you start in very early universe with vacuum state, for instance, for simplicity, then you amplify this state in the very early universe. Okay, early universe is a great amplifier. Then what you will get wave functional, okay, which describe, let me write like this one, all kind of configurations for the energy density distribution. The wave function. But initial state is translationally invariant, right? Universe is homogeneous. Therefore, final state should be translationally invariant. Now, what we see today on the sky doesn't remain any kind of translational invariance at all, correct? So for instance, if you will look, the Andromeda or whatsoever is located in particular place. And then you ask at which moment translational invariance was broken. Because in the original result, if I solve Schrödinger equation, there will be full translational invariance. And here we have to refer to Mr. Bohr, because according to Copenhagen interpretation, I would say, or Bohr would say, I would never say it. Okay, first astronomer looked at the sky and then he made reduction of this translation invariant wave functional, okay, to the wave functional where Andromeda is located in particular place. But in original wave functional, if you would expand it, of course, there would be all positions for Andromeda. I don't understand why everybody is laughing. Why? Because everybody says that if you will ask people on the street, not on the street, I mean physicists, that they believe in Bohr interpretation of quantum mechanics. But as Bryce David wrote once, people who say that they believe in Bohr, say, that they believe in Bohr interpretation, quantum mechanics, remind him American who believes in Bill of Rights or American Constitution without even reading it. So, normally people have no idea what they are talking about, of course. And, okay, now I will continue with the talk, which I think gave only twice after I left Soviet Union, but in Soviet Union I gave it 300 times with the same success. So it means it was complete failure. But then when I came in the United States, I saw that it's a free democratic country, and therefore, okay, physicists are also open-minded. And for instance, first time I gave talk on interpretation of quantum mechanics in Brooklyn College, and it was just interview talk. As a result, of course, I collapsed my wave function to the state when job disappeared, and everybody was running from me like I'm crazy. Perhaps they had reason. Now, third time, it was 2003, in Stanford, there was a conference paid by Templeton Foundation on multiverse and anthropic principle, but there was mostly physicists. Okay, Lenny Susskind was there, Andrei, of course, Renata, Tegmark. It was organized by Paul Davies mostly. And, of course, there was one theologist, one philosopher, but here I make no comment. And then, actually, I gave talk also on interpretation of quantum mechanics. After my talk, I decided to make pool. I asked, who believes in Copenhagen interpretation of quantum mechanics? Nobody raised hand. I asked, who believes in many world interpretation of quantum mechanics? Nobody raised hand. I asked, who do not care? Nobody raised hand. Up to now, I still try to find good interpretation of these facts. Because, okay, when I was doing similar pool, okay, among students in Munich, then everybody, okay, 50% raised hand for many world, Bohmian, I don't even mention, okay, because as Einstein said, okay, he doesn't want to discuss trivialities, okay. For instance, other thing which was very interesting also, that in Soviet Union, you understand that interpretation of quantum mechanics had practical applications because it was ideologically important. And I will tell you two real stories. At the time when I started to be interested in it, okay, of course, I found everywhere reference to Wigner-Friend paradox. And reference was to this book, Collection of Papers by Wigner, Symmetries and Reflections, I guess. Then I have Russian translation of the book. I went through it line by line, but I could not find anything like this one. And I didn't know why people refer always to this book, where I didn't find anything. But puzzle I resolved in 1988, when I went to United States for the first time and took English copy of this book. And then I discovered that two papers from this book during translation were kept. One was about nuclear disarmament, because Wigner had map where in Russia were located all missiles. Everybody in America knew, but for Russians it was impossible, okay? Prohibited to know this thing. And second paper was called Two Kind of Realities. You see? And of course, Two kind of realities. And of course, it was in complete contradiction with Marxism-Leninism, therefore also it was skipped. Moreover, how I got in this kind of affairs with quantum mechanics, well, I asked in 84, I think, there appeared paper by Hartle Hawking, and I told to my supervisor, Markov, who was at this time, I think, already 85, that we have to invite somebody to give talk about interpretation of the wave function of the universe. And then Markov told, no, come on. There is no in Soviet Union who really is specialist in this question, and the biggest specialist, Markov said, he is. Why? Because in 1948, he wrote paper for the journal Questions of Philosophy about Bohr interpretation of quantum mechanics and Marxism-Leninism, and he tried to reconcile both things, and he did it quite nicely, I have to tell. And of course, paper was approved even by KGB guys. But somebody perhaps missed something, so next day, or maybe in a week after that, some official Russian newspaper, Pravda, wrote paper about Markov, calling him that he is philosophical Centaurus, half horse, half human. And of course, what would be the consequence for Markov? They already, his wife told that they already packed their things and were prepared to go to this Stalin concentration camp. So you see how important is interpretation of quantum mechanics. But again, they were saved. Why? Because Kurchatov called directly to Beria and told that, okay, if you will not leave physicists alone, and if philosophers, okay, will interfere with physics, we will not guarantee that this bomb which we are doing will explode. And after that, physics will exist in very well without philosophical intervention. As you know very well. Then also, of course, when I was giving talks, it was always the same question. Ginsburg was coming to me, telling Slava, I again forget what is Schrödinger cat, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Why won't you? I tell, okay, yes, what he told. No, I already reserved for you seminar in a week, 2 hours. But of course, this during 2 hours, I could speak only 5 minutes because after that, all 300 people were speaking simultaneously. As you know, interpretation of quantum mechanics and the arrow of time together with entropy makes everybody crazy. And everybody cares about it much more than about 26 or 11 dimensions, as you know. Why? Because people take it seriously. But let me now go, okay, to something and remind you, because Thibault was speaking about Everett, but he was covered mostly quantum cosmology, as I was told. Let me tell you actually what was known before Everett. In fact, actually everything, including non-demolition measurement theory, you can find in the best ever written book on the foundation of quantum mechanics. And you know this best ever written book is von Neumann book, Mathematical Foundation of Quantum Mechanics. Everything is there concerning measurement theory, even non-demolition measurement theory. And after that, okay, I will add what after that Everett and Bryce David added to this picture. And as a good example, let me start, okay, with the example of Stern-Gerlach experiment, because it's most obvious thing, very simple, but it's very representative to explain all the main concept which became very popular very recently in relation with quantum computers. Okay, so let me take silver atom, okay, located in some position at the beginning, one silver atom. So its wave function which describes position. Then this is spin state, spin up, spin down, B down, and then I want to measure spin. How I do it? In the direction. I put here slightly inhomogeneous magnetic field. And then I send this silver atom within this inhomogeneous magnetic field. Then I can solve Schrödinger equation because it's more or less trivial problem. Yeah, exactly. And then what I will find happens with, colored shock. Okay, I wanted colored shock. What happens with this wave packet? It, here it starts to split. It's a solution of Schrödinger equation. And then part of the wave packet goes up, and the other part of the wave packet goes down, like this one. Finally, they do not overlap anymore. Then what you do next in the measurement? Of course, you have to detect this atom. Then you put somewhere here, for instance, amplifiers, okay, or detectors, like for particles. Connect them with wires, with some kind of device. And what is device for me? It's some kind of big thing, which I can see with my eyes, and which has pointer here before it will get signal from here or from here. Or if, for instance, it gets signal from here, then pointer goes in this position. If it gets signal from here, pointer goes in this position. But let me now include device also in the wave function. Of course, it's complicated wave function in some kind of multidimensional, many-dimensional Hilbert space, but this Hilbert space you can divide anyway on the blocks, for instance, and say that at the beginning when pointer was here, wave function for this detector was like d0, yeah? This means not precise value of the wave function, but it means that it belongs to some subclass in the Hilbert space. For instance, one electron can change here its situation, but pointer will be still here. It's microscopic thing, yeah? Then, okay, when, for instance, pointer will go on the left side, then wave function, I will denote the detector has seen this thing in this position. When on the right side pointer goes, then it would correspond to wave function d, okay, down, something like this one. Now, for the fun, also, I want to include myself when I see on this kind of, when I look at this device. Because I'm not very different from device, I have not so high opinion about two kind of reality in my head, okay? I am like normal robot, yeah? Nothing contradicts to this thing. So let me write here also y function observer. And here I will write either zero, up or down, depending what I will see with my eyes. Now, I start at some moment before the experiment began, with the state, okay, alpha, not alpha, yeah, this kind of state, which should be multiplied by d, zero, okay, to include device. Then after that, it should be still multiplied by observer to also which didn't see the state of the pointer, okay? So it's still in central state. Now, if I will solve Schrödinger equation, of course, you can tell me, how can I solve Schrödinger equation for so many degrees of freedom? But in fact, you know its solution, because you know that if spin would be up, for sure, if this coefficient would be equal to zero, then pointer for sure would go on the left, right? And after that, you just apply superposition principle to this kind of initial state, and as a result of the unitary evolution, what you are getting the following state. Alpha, psi up, of course, it's wave function which went along this upper direction, then you have spin up, then you have detector which has seen or registered which had arrow pointer which went on the left, and of course observer who is me, who also have seen this arrow or pointer which went on the left. Plus, there will be second term beta, then psi down, okay, so it's wave function, normalized wave packet, who went in this direction, spin down, then detector head and pointer which went on the right, and observer who has seen different picture for the pointer. Now, what I got here? I got here expression on the basis of which you can explain three or two most used now in quantum and the string community notion like decoherence and entanglement, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So you see that after observation, in spite of the fact there is no any more interaction, for instance, of the silver atom with any devices, wave function is nevertheless not factorizable. You cannot write it as a product of two-wave functions in spite of the fact that there is no interaction. It's so-called entanglement. Second thing, How can you see decoherence? You understand, of course, that these two states, like detector spin up and detector spin down, yeah, wave function, they should be orthogonal, of course, because you understand that this wave function do not overlap. Or moreover, if you have macroscopical device, then if you will take two arbitrary state vectors in the Hilbert space, they are nearly always orthogonal. You see, from here it follows that you have now decoherence. So these two branches stop to communicate with each other. Third thing which you can see here, the appearance of schizophrenic state for the observer. So I have to see simultaneously spin up and spin down. And this is nothing more, superposition of this thing. This is Schrödinger cat. Schrödinger cat is always there. In any experiment, you are getting Schrödinger cat. In fact, when I was speaking about wave function of the universe, after amplifying this quantum fluctuation to macroscopical state, I got schizophrenic state of Schrödinger cat. Now, what actually was the suggestion of, I won't say that it was Bohr even, okay? So Bohr was a lot of philosophical, how to say, not blah, blah, okay, writing on the top of these rules, which were formulated very well in von Neumann. Okay, von Neumann, let me now actually, just to save chalk and time, do not write all the pieces of wave function, just let's write my spin path, which I am measuring. So what von Neumann says after that? Okay, until the moment of interaction with macroscopical device, evolution was unitary, but at a certain point, you have to break unitarity in the evolution. Why? Because otherwise, you will find yourself in a schizophrenic state. And nobody, besides of, as we think, sick people, is in a schizophrenic state normally. So I cannot be simultaneously here and here. Therefore, okay, according to this von Neumann, see, you have to postulate that at some stage this wave function is reduced as a result of, in this particular case, of some kind of uncontrollable interaction, not uncontrollable interaction, as a result of some, I don't know how it's called, process, either to spin up or spin down. And this reduction here, of course, as you know very well, happens with probabilities alpha squared and beta squared. And this is principle, in principle, non-unitary evolution already at this stage. Therefore, sometimes I do not understand why people care so much about unitarities when they speak, for instance, in string theory about information paradox in the presence of black hole. In fact, you have this kind of non-unitary evolution if you believe in something like many, like Copenhagen interpretation all the time. Now, where to put this place where you make this reduction? As you have seen, I can shift it, for instance. I can say that I can, after splitting of two-wave packet, I can say that something happened, and instead of two-wave packet, one just survived with some probability. But it seems that there is no reason to say so, especially if you are solving Schrödinger equation perfectly well. Then you say, you can say that maybe you can refer this thing to the place where the signal was amplified in this detector, because there are many degrees of freedom and God knows what will happen, but you have to realize that irrespectively what would happen, it will not resolve the problem. Then the best way after many years, okay, of discussion, which some people found, they shifted this kind of reduction or this kind of non-unitary process in the human mind. I'm not kidding. Okay, if you will look what Euler was writing, it was precisely like this one. Moreover, von Neumann, okay, this arbitrariness of the point where you are putting this kind of reduction called principle of psychophysical parallelism even. You see, in principle, if you would say that reduction happened at the moment when two wave packets split it, you still could doubt this thing, yeah, and you could check it happened or not happened. And then you would find that you can put, with the help of the other magnetic field, two wave packets together, and you would find that it didn't happen. But when you move it in this big amplifier, there is no practical, as I want to stress, practical way to check it. You see, because everything gets very decoherent. Because, okay, there is many degrees of freedom which are not under control, just simply. Now, if you put it in the human mind, I do not know what you have to do. You see, you have to make interference experiment, actually on human minds, and then, I guess, on animal, of course, you cannot do it because they will be defended immediately by some society. Okay, but on human, in principle, you could do it. But nevertheless, practically, it's impossible. Now, what could be the possible resolution of this thing? By the way, Schrödinger, actually, when he realized this kind of thing, he wrote that if he would know what would be the philosophical consequence of this theory, I would never write Schrödinger equation. Moreover, Bohr made so complicated philosophy. I have read all the papers there, okay? 5 years I was just studying this subject, okay? Reading this interchange of messages, etc. Bohr was writing so confusing philosophy, which, for instance, I could characterize with two statements. When for somebody asked Bohr, what electron is doing between the act of emission and act of registration? No, what electron is to be, okay, between act of emission and act of registration? Bohr said, to be, what does it mean to be itself? Of course, it sounds very good, but it doesn't reply, it doesn't answer anything, as you understand. Then, after that, there was discussion of separate classical reality and quantum reality, but you said, what is the difference between quantum mechanics? When I'm teaching classical mechanics to the student, when I come to Hamiltonian formalism, I tell that this is great formalism. You just put hats everywhere in these equations, postulate PQ is equal IH, and after that I leave you quantum theory for derivation as a homework. In fact, actually, after that you can get everything, as you know. And then you do not understand, okay, you think that classical reality, at least as described by quantum mechanics, as described by classical mechanics, should be limiting case, right? But here you are getting somehow strange things. Therefore, the first way to escape from all these kind of paradoxes created the whole, I think, community of so-called statistical interpreters of quantum mechanics. And by the way, Einstein also was discussing this thing, and people were saying, no, this quantum mechanics describe just ensemble of the experiment. And the only prediction, for instance, which you are making for the expectation value of operator R, which is measurable, is nothing more than just trace rho R. And therefore, wave function refers only to ensemble of experiment. It's not the case. And why it's not the case? Because in quantum mechanics, there are two kinds of experiments. There is experiments which you can make repeatedly on many objects which are prepared in the same state. The other experiment is the sequence of experiment on the same single quantum object. For instance, imagine that as a result of the first experiment, you found spin up. After that, you make second experiment to measure spin, and then prediction is that you will find this 100% probability spin up. If you continue this measurement, then spin up will stay always the same. To explain this kind of experiment, inevitably, you have to refer wave function to particular quantum object. Otherwise, there is no way to escape. Because the best say, okay, or you can say still, quantum mechanics describes it statistically, right? Then if, but I can nevertheless include myself also in the wave function, right? Then if quantum mechanics describes things statistically, and I include myself in the wave function, then I should be also a statistical object, and there should be many copies of myself. But I see only one copy of myself when I look in the mirror, right? Where are all the other copies?
It depends on how much you have drunk before.
Enough. But even in this case, I see only one copy. But you see, the thing, how you can reconcile this thing, okay? Statistical thing is good. But where all are my other copies? And then there is a ingenious, I think, not ingenious, really genius answer, which Everett gave, that what in reality quantum mechanics describes, it describes the ensemble of many universes. And particular definition of the particular universe is related with the fact that I am is I am, as you understand. Let me a little bit, let me elaborate this thing, yeah. So if I will take this kind of attitude about reduction of the wave function, it's of course very unpleasant thing about which Einstein was very unhappy, and he was telling God plays dice, and also he could not understand why device should be different in principle from the quantum mechanical object. Device is just large, okay, from his point of view, or we should be different. But it was not main obstacle of Einstein, okay, and why he was unhappy. The other obstacle was the fact that in quantum mechanics, during practically any amplification process, you are getting the states, okay, of so-called alive and dead Schrödinger cat. You see, what we know that these kind of schizophrenic states exist. And we measure them. Now, why nevertheless, okay, we should not believe in this kind of schizophrenic states? Of course, on practical side, we cannot measure them because of decoherence, but nevertheless, as a result of the solution of Schrödinger equations, they come all the time. And then you understand that, okay? After that, Einstein tried to make map between the object which you have, or between the symbols which you have in your theory with reality. So let's take this kind of state. You know that if state would be like this one, okay, for Schrödinger cat, you know that you have some universe where Schrödinger cat, okay, now I am drawing cat, so this tail, this is reality, this is symbol. Then reality would be in one-to-one correspondence with this symbol. If the cat would be dead, then it's again, okay, maybe not so great reality, but you have here dead cat. So until now it's very good. But then, as a result of Schrödinger solution of Schrödinger equation, you are getting this kind of thing. And there is no reality which would correspond to this symbol in spite of the fact that you got it as a result of unitary evolution. And therefore, of course, you attribute it to here or attribute it to here, but when you say you are becoming the member of this process, of attributing. And what is our particular role, in fact, in our universe? Not very special. You see, we live in ordinary galaxy, on ordinary planet, and we are completely ordinary. And Einstein was thinking that science really describes nature irrespective of us. And he tried to find the law of nature. And Bohr was writing, no, quantum mechanics is some kind of device which is helpful for our life. And then Einstein, of course, as you know very well, was telling that in this case I would prefer to be shoemaker. Plumber. Even plumber, okay. So some people, in fact, sometimes translate Einstein not so, because, for instance, when Einstein about cosmological constants said that it was his greatest SLI. Yeah, people translate it in English, mistake, but it's...
Blunder.
Yeah, so blunder, yeah. But it's not blunder, okay, as we know very well. So, but you understand that, okay, it was one of the very upsetting things. Now, what happened in... So there was no one-to-one correspondence between symbols and reality, and you needed always somebody, okay, who is alive, who makes sense out of quantum mechanics. So Einstein was telling, come on, universe exists without us and will still exist without us. From the point of view of Bohr, in spite of the fact that what I will say right now would sound, how to say it, stupid, yeah? But nevertheless, you can read and check. From the point of view of Bohr, if you would make logical conclusion, okay, all this universe which existed 10 billion years makes sense only on our lifetime. Because otherwise, what is the point to describe it? Especially if you start with quantum fluctuations, yeah? So now, there is the other things also. What does it mean classical limit? Of course, we understand that if object is very large and stable, then you can describe very well up to uncertainty relations this object with classical mechanics, right? But in more fundamental way, you should be able to describe it with quantum mechanics. And for instance, take ball like this one. Okay, 1 kilogram, absolutely stable. At the beginning, wave packet for the center of mass is like this one. Wait 100 billion years. Nothing happens with the ball, right? Nothing happens, because I just postulate that it's absolutely stable. If I will solve Schrödinger equation for this ball, what will I get? In 100 of billion years, I will get wave packet like this one. So what does it mean, this thing? Of course, according to Bohr, observer should come, look at this thing, and then make reduction of the wave function to one of the positions. And he tells that the ball, in principle, could move to this position because you cannot fix precisely, okay, the initial momenta, because there is uncertainty relation. Right? But how you will be getting classical limit from quantum mechanical equations in this case? How do you think?
The mass is very large. So.
Mass is very large, but nevertheless, wave function wait billions of billions of billions of years. Wave function will become like this one, very, very widely spread. And especially if there is some kind of potential here, how you would get actually, because according to so-called Ehrenfest theorem, I don't know what is, if you will take some kind of position, then you have to take expectation value, and then this expectation value should satisfy classical equation, correct? But after you will wait hundreds of hundreds of hundreds of billion years, when wave function will spread, anyway it will spread, okay, you will take this expectation value, you will find that, okay, it doesn't satisfy classical equation, but nothing changed. It will start again to satisfy classical equation if, okay, observer will come and make out of this wave function with the act of observation reduction. You see? For instance, one of the simplest examples is, it was again considered by Einstein.
Sorry, Slava, I don't see why I cannot simply say that repeated measurements should give the same answer.
And not no, repeated measurement will give the same answer.
I don't, why do I need to talk?
Wait, you measured first. Then after that, you waited for a very long time. You got as a result of the solution of Schrödinger equation something. After that, you want to take this something and still get, okay, classical limit, because by definition, our ball was 1 kilogram and was infinitely stable. Then you say, what you do? Okay, you got wave function as a result of the solution of Schrödinger equation without making measurements there. And then how you would actually recover with this wave function classical limit?
But the thing, any realistic ball would be many, many atoms, so you would have many interactions and you would have
correct. No, 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 wait. As I said, let's consider ideal situation. For a minute, I don't want actually...
About a huge electron or something.
Huge electron whatsoever, you can write some object. It's not really actually the big problem, yeah? But nevertheless, you have to get classical limit. Moreover... You, as I said, you can easily take one ball, use some kind of amplification mechanism, and then get for this ball, one ball, as I said, yeah, wave function, which has two peaks around two coordinates, x1, x2. And ball 1 kilogram, you see? It's actually what Einstein hated, because you... He was discussing the example where the wave function of the moon has two peaks in the opposite orbits of the moon. And he was telling, okay, he has never seen this kind of reality, but you are getting it very easily. And here, for instance, if you would denote it psi 1 and this one psi 2, and would start to calculate expectation values, yeah? For instance, if you had this superposition alpha psi 1 plus beta psi 2, then you can easily convince yourself if there is potential like x cubed, yeah, here. Then classical equation was x2 dot plus x squared, 1/3, okay, is equal to 0. Now, if you will take x in this particular case, expectation value, which will be psi x psi, then, of course, this x bar coordinate will never satisfy equation. Okay, you can add here terms which are proportional to the Planck constant, if you want. It will never satisfy equation like this one. Moreover, you can check yourself that if you will take expectation value over this function, yeah, then equation for x will be like alpha, alpha squared, then here in brackets s1, 2 dot plus x1 squared plus beta squared x2 dot plus x2 squared is equal to 0 up to corrections proportional to h. So you see what you got as a result? You have big ball, you have this strange wave function, but you have just sum of two classical equations. What does it remind you? It reminds you that this wave function describes at least two universes in which of which you have classical limit.
Slava, excuse me. You take a classical limit in a Schrödinger equation. It's pretty well known that you have to do the right thing. So if you write Schrödinger equation, that equation has a classical limit. It has a meaning. And you will get the Hamiltonian equation. I mean, it depends what you take classical limit for.
Samson, it's okay. You always have to do right thing. And I am telling you how to do right thing. Therefore, I can reformulate, okay, for you everything in terms of Hamiltonian approach and even in terms of operators, not in terms of wave function. Wave function, okay, for explaining this problem is a little bit more convenient because otherwise, if you... No, wait. Okay. It's not confusing, Samson, okay? We can discuss it a little bit later, but I am sure that a lot of people can start to object right now, and then I will never end up, as you understand.
I'm not objective. I'm saying in a Dirac book on quantum mechanics, it's written how to take classical limits.
Look,
let me...
Saying the classical limit is the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, which describes
yes.
an infinite number of classical
transitive worlds. That's correct.
This is the classical limit of Schrödinger.
That's correct. That's the limit of the Schrödinger equation, which makes sense as a classical equation.
No, actually, what I wanted to say, very simple thing. That you can make from quantum mechanics classical limit if you have large object for which you can define so-called macroscopic variables, which we discussed for 5 hours with Jörg and Tibor 2 days ago. But you see, you nevertheless has to do it in a smart way. And here, what I showed you, when you have superposition of like this one for the ball, 1 kilogram mass, you have to make classic, to have classical limit, you have to assume that there are two classical universes. And in one universe, okay, you have the same equation with the different initial conditions. You see? And moreover, I do not see anywhere in mathematics why universe should be preferable compared to the other universe. You have again to bring more if you want to tell that one is realistic, the other is non-realistic. But I don't want to have so exceptional mind about myself that God created quantum mechanics for my personal use. You see, we are just normal robots somehow. Now, what Everett did? In fact, what Everett did great thing, which I think was never appreciated even by John Wheeler. You see, because I am recorded, I will skip a lot of quotes. For instance, when I asked once Ginsburg what Landau thought about interpretation of quantum mechanics, okay, answer was not very diplomatic. Therefore, I will not quote it here. Because you know that as Landau normally say, oh, all these questions about Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen paradox, actually, you have to address to Bohr. Only he understands this thing. And then after that, okay, take Bohr paper about Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen paradox. 30 pages, blah, blah, blah. At the end, you are confused even more than at the beginning, what I would say. But this is, okay, this is very good for political discussion, right? But it's not the way how science should work. Now, what Everett did, therefore, let me actually just summarize. He invented what people called many-world interpretation of quantum mechanics, but the name, I think, was given by either Bryce, I think. Bryce, yeah. Bryce gave this name. So what Everett did? Let's write this schizophrenic state for spin up, yeah? So, for spin up, and then observer also spin up. And plus beta spin down. No, okay, and then detector spin down, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. He said that not only one of these terms has reality, but also this superposition has reality. And in fact, to what it corresponds, it corresponds to many parallel worlds. And in fact, actually, quantum mechanics, in principle, is the science which simultaneously describes ensemble of the worlds. Different worlds, not words, because we had very long discussion, I think, somewhere in Sevilla, with Gelman was participating. Should we distinguish words from worlds? And I think we have to distinguish it somehow, but as you correctly say, how much did you have drink before, okay? Then it's okay. And then whatever I said, that in this particular case, there are this wave function describe whole ensemble of universes, how many we can discuss separately, where in alpha squared percentage, spin is up, in beta squared, okay, multiplied by n, universe spin is down. No, and appropriately, of course, detector here is in this state, in this universe. In the other universes, detector is in different state. Now, if I would not include detectors, I could not even define this field, because after that, rearranging basis for decomposition, I could speak about worlds where spin, for instance, has value which is perpendicular, yeah, in x direction. Now, when the meaning of world starts to make sense? Only when there appears some object which we can recognize macroscopically, because we are macroscopical objects. You see, and in this particular case, when I am distracting interference, or I am getting decoherence, the notion of world gets particular meaning. Otherwise, you cannot speak about different worlds. It's actually they are all together. You see, it's like the same thing. The statement, different worlds in this case, would not make too much sense because these worlds interfering too much. You see, for instance, like statement, okay, imagine that you have two protons and electron makes 1,000 rotation around this electron, and then jumps here, makes one rotation, jumps back to this proton. Then you say that electron belongs to this center, right? Now, if it would be different situation, if electron would be making 1,000 rotation here, and then jumping here once, you would say that electron belongs to this center. But if it would be jumping between them, you would not actually say this kind of thing. Now, worlds are not completely non-observable, because if there is even decoherence, there are effects which are proportional to the Planck constant. You see? And each of them you can just define, making the decomposition of the wave function, which describes everything, in some kind of sum, Cnt psi preferable n, okay, like this one, which also you can take as a function of t, by the way. And then all this kind of preferable function you can define after identifying so-called macroscopical variables, which we can see with our eyes, like location of the ball 1 kilogram, right? And then all this set of macroscopical variables I would describe by the set of operators Mn, yeah? And then would request that expectation values for them over the preferable basis component satisfy classical equation with the accuracy, which is like ratio of Planck constant to the typical action which is related with this kind of process. You see, if I will claim that I want to get quantum mechanics, classical mechanics as a limiting case of quantum mechanics, then the set of Everett parallel universes is unambiguously defined. Now, what we get as a result of this kind of blah, blah, blah for 1.5 hours? First of all, in this case, we are not puzzled anymore with collapse of the wave function. You are not actually, as a result of determining spin up or down, make any reduction. You just discover in which branch you are located. Therefore, no collapse. No collapse. So, for the ensemble of universes, God doesn't... Wait, sorry. I thought that perhaps I could give talk without microphone. It would be more entertaining. So, okay, good. So now... okay, thank you. Now, in a sense, science again becomes deterministic. You take Schrödinger equation or Euler-David equation for the whole universe, and you determine everything. So it's you can speak for Euler-David equation about boundary condition problem, because in Euler-David equation there is no even time, you see? But this is not Laplace determinism, because it describes you just deterministically the whole ensemble of the universes. On one side, it's deterministic, but on the other side, you see. You could have many parallel universes with the same past up to this moment of time, but with different future. You see? Therefore, even if you know your past completely, 100%, nevertheless, you cannot predict your future. So on one side, it's determinist for the whole ensemble of the universe, but you yourself identify in each particular universe when you go along your world line. And, okay, your copies are identifying themselves differently. But one of the important statements here, that in, for instance, if quantum mechanics has reality, and it has reality because it was proved by the measurement, then all copies of myself are as real as myself. I do not say that they are real. I say they are as real as I. You see, it doesn't mean the statement that I am real. Or I can imagine that you are all my imagination. Or maybe in the other parallel universe, I am criticizing Everett, perhaps. Jörg, this is very unlikely event. So the number of the universes where I criticize Everett is extremely small. Now, second thing, okay? What we are getting? We are getting one-to-one correspondence between reality and science. You see? I think it's also a great thing, it's a dream of Einstein, that science makes sense even in our absence. And we are nothing more than just automats, okay? More complicated than even Japanese robots. A little bit. Now, classical limit in each particular universe you always get when you have big enough object for which you can forget about uncertainty relation. There is no obstacle about getting classical limit for macroscopic superpositions. You just take actually one of the component of preferable basis, and then classical limit you can recover in the limit when Planck constant goes to zero. Because you should not forget that quantum mechanics is different from classical in two respects. One is uncertainty relation, and the other thing, there appear all the time Schrödinger cats everywhere as a result of natural amplification of macroscopic event by some amplifier. And these superpositions do not disappear when you take h goes to zero. Schrödinger cat, after you created it, doesn't disappear after you took h goes to zero. But on the other side, to get Schrödinger cat, you needed to have at the beginning h non-equal zero. So, third thing, classical limit is well defined. And I describe how to define. Now, what about statistics? Should I postulate, because I still have 5 minutes, right? So, should I postulate statistics, or it's already there within the whole scheme here? And what I will try to show you, you should not postulate Born rule. You can get it somehow in a natural way. Okay, it's very short, nearly trivial calculation, yeah? But again, no mathematical rigor. See, therefore, do not just blame me for the absence of this thing, but I am sure that, okay, we can discuss with Jörg and make it completely rigorous, right? Good. So, what I want to get? I want to get, derive the rule that if my electron, okay, was in the state alpha up plus beta down, Then, if I will take n electrons, or silver atoms, better to say, in the same state, then in the limit when n goes to infinity, okay, the number of electrons which spin of silver atom we spin up will be like this one. And the number of electrons we spin down will be beta squared multiplied by n. And of course, here also, because it's finite number of experiment, I will have uncertainty, or how to call this error, like square root of n, correct? Because this alpha squared n makes sense only when n goes to infinity. Now, let me derive this formula. For that, let me make experiment taking, okay, n copies of spin up. Alpha up plus beta down, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Alpha up plus beta spin down. Okay, and this should be multiplied by detector with n channels for all outcomes of the result of the experiment on each particular silver atom, right? But just to simplify formula, you understand that you keep in mind detector, but let's skip this term just for simplification. If you want, you can restore it. And let's write alpha spin up plus beta spin down in power n. And let's write it explicitly. What is this? Of course, you know very well what is this, because it's sum over all n. Then here alpha in power n, beta in power n capital minus n. And you have also subsum, which is permutation, all kind of possible permutation of spin up, okay, down, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But in this sum, the number of spin up is n. Yeah, n, n small, and the number of spin down here, spin up is n small, and the number of spin down is n capital minus n. Now let's take this thing and say that it's okay wave function where, as a result of measurement, you are getting n small outcome for spin up, n capital minus n small for spin down, or vice versa. And let's normalize it on unity. Then, you know that the number of permutations here is n factorial, and then here divided by n factorial small, n capital minus n factorial. Correct? Now, if you want to have to this normalization for wave function squared, of course, as it should be, yeah, you have to divide this thing by square root of n capital divided by n small, n capital minus n small factorial. And of course, appropriately, you have to multiply this thing also by square root. N factorial divided by n, n minus n factorial. And now let's look limit when n goes to infinity. And let's take, for instance, you can take any power of this function, but let's take for simplicity squared, okay? And then you will get here alpha absolute value, yeah? And then what will be this distribution? This distribution for the coefficient in front of the appropriate component will be n factorial divided by n minus n, n factorial, n, n small factorial, alpha magnitude 2, n beta 2, n minus n. And you know also that alpha squared plus beta squared is equal 1. So what you got binomial distribution. And this binomial distribution is like this one, okay? So it's centered when n goes to infinity, it's Gaussian distribution with the center N capital multiplied by alpha squared. You see, N, how bright it is, it's precisely square root of N. Now you understand that when you take N goes to infinity limit, then in this superposition, only coefficient in front of the wave functions with the right statistic will survive. All other will disappear. And in such a way, you are getting also, okay, internal description of statistic in this so-called many-world interpretation. Also, now, what became measurement? Last sentence, yeah? So normally, look, I can tell you that I hate Lagrangian formalism and I just love Hamiltonian formalism because Hamiltonian formalism plus commutation relation, everything, okay, is done for quantum mechanics, quantum field theory, whatsoever. But there is one nice, great thing about Hamiltonian formalism, because if you want to have the theory of non-demolition measurement, when you want to measure some quantity, okay, assuming that your system was in eigenstate of this quantity, okay, if you want to do it on practical level, it's very easy to formulate this thing in terms of the Hamiltonian formalism. Yeah? For instance, and actually, in fact, the whole theory of non-demolition measurement is made on prototype which von Neumann introduced in his book. Namely, in the Hamiltonian, you are adding the quantity gamma, which is coupling constant, x, which is the quantity which you want to measure, and some p, where p is the conjugated operator to the observable which you can see with your eyes. And von Neumann considered non-demolition measurement, for instance, for the position of electron. And using this Hamiltonian, what he did? He took electron in the same location, okay, ball, 1 kilogram mass, okay, introduce this interaction, and as a result of this interaction, depending on the strength of gamma, electron stays in the same position, but this big ball goes on the right 1 kilometer. You see, it's a so nice interaction, but how to realize it practically is big question. But from where you are getting energy from this coupling? It's clear that for any measurement, you have to have coupling. Now, even for the measurement of electromagnetic field, which actually was described in a very sophisticated way by Bohr and Sommer Rosenfeld, yeah, where you have to have compensation mechanism. All these compensation mechanisms you can get very easily in three lines if you start with Hamiltonian first. And then when you go to the Lagrangian, when you try to realize the things, you are getting them in three lines here. Now, what is interaction? Nothing special. I am sorry, measurement is just normal interaction, like we all have, okay? As a result of which, the things just amplify. In this sense, this kind of even non-demolition interaction is similar to amplification of this, of quantum fluctuation in the early universe, okay, which gives us quantum mechanics, which we see today on the sky. Okay, so I studied with sky, and now I put the other brackets with sky. I finish.
I'd like to question. I mean, I agree very much with what you say. I have a question which is not about interpretation, but about reality. Do you believe that quantum mechanics applies to the extent that quantum computers will work?
I think it applies, and it's only technical problem. The problem which I have with quantum computer, I do not know what to use them for, okay? This is a different problem, because what is quantum computer, in fact, as I described? It's like N computers, classical computers, which are working in parallel universes, but communication between these and parallel universes is non-perfect. So you can pass from each universe only one divided by n amount of information. And you have to pick up so-called interesting information. And actually, the way how to pick up this interesting information is called quantum algorithm, as we know very well. And we know that up to now, we have quantum, all quantum algorithms are based on the determination of period of periodic function, including Shor algorithm. Then why it's useful? Of course, if people would make quantum computers 10 years ago, before they developed quantum cryptography, we could solve all money problems, of course. Because all the codes in banks could be broken within 3 minutes. For that, for what you are requiring for the normal computer, how much time? Okay, 10 billion years. And it would be solved with quantum computer, which would consist of 200 qubits. Now, with this quantum optics, people went quite far already. Okay, I think they have, how many? 10 or maybe 15 qubits. Huh? Eight, only eight. But eight is already good, because I recall that 15 years ago there was no hope to get even two or maybe three. We were discussing this thing in this decoherence conference in Utrecht. So I think it will work. The other thing, not everybody needs it, and moreover, I now do not know people who need it, in fact. You see, therefore, people should work on quantum algorithms, perhaps, because it's actually really, from my point of view, great area. Could be great area, but since 95, past 20 years, nothing principally new compared to Shor.
I'm not sure I have followed your argument about the statistical interpretation, but I heard recently maybe the same argument in the same Zurek, and he was claiming that all I need to assume is symmetry. So suppose you take alpha equals beta equals 1 over square root 2.
Yes.
Then, in a sense, if I'm going to put any probabilistic interpretation, I better put the half and the half to the two states by symmetry.
Okay. And?
Now, if you accept this, it sounds like a nice argument. Then you can easily generalize, because you can just count cases.
Okay.
Is this what?
Perhaps, what can be else there? In fact, actually, this whole thing in different form was invented already in 63. Finkelstein wrote this in 68.
This is probably ancient. What you're doing is say there are n copies of your world, and if n becomes very large, obviously.
Very good, Jörg. The only thing which I said that Bohr, okay, Max Bohr, Born. Got Nobel Prize for this, not derivation, but for postulating that alpha squared is probability, as you know very well. Of course, most of the people in most of the books on quantum mechanics write that it's postulate. If you show me one single book where this kind of arguments, okay, are presented, then I agree with you, but I don't want to surprise you with it, as you understand. Huh? It's just normal,
I mean, people said that quantum mechanics applies to ensembles of many sort of identical copies.
Yes.
Very ancient thing, people always say.
No, I am sorry, okay? If you say that quantum mechanics is applicable only to the n copies of identical system, and if you are the member of the system, then there should be many like you also. Then you have to make next step and admit many-world interpretation, right?
I mean, since we discussed it for an afternoon, let's not.
No, for the whole afternoon, I think we fix the things with set of so-called AS, with this OS algebra, It was different. You see, now we are discussing, of course, you can say that you don't care about your own copies in the other universe, In principle, I also can tell that I don't care. You know that, okay, our nice friend, whom I don't want to, I want to quote him, but I will not name him. Okay, he tells that, about quantum mechanics, shut up and calculate. Of course, if you are enjoying just calculation, shut up and calculate. But somebody told that sometimes you want to understand what is going on and why we are calculating. And then, second thing, by the way, you should not forget that all these kind of things are very important when you formulate the problem. You know, like my friend Batalin told us, okay, God gave, no, he said like this one, that equation should solve mathematician and physicist should formulate initial or boundary condition problem. It's our job. And for formulation of this problem, of course, it's quite important to have right ideology. I know it especially well because I have grown in Soviet Union and now I'm in capitalistic world. I know what does it mean ideology.
At the beginning of your talk, you dismissed Bohmian mechanics, and it seemed to be because it was a bit funny. So my question is not why do you think Bohmian mechanics is wrong, but why do you think it is ludicrous?
I will tell you. Okay, so if you take 1 degree of freedom, rewrite equation, Schrödinger equation, this continuity equation, etc., 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 then you can put some word on 1 degree of freedom. And then say that you convinced yourself that there is no problem, yeah? Now, take 2 degrees of freedom and go to Bohm paper from 60-something. It already starts to look a little bit ridiculous, yeah? But I can, okay, suggest you better things. Take quantum field theory and try to implement this Bohmian mechanic, okay, interpreting what people call normally Tomanaga-Schwinger equation. So equation for quantum fields in Schrödinger representation. You will never, ever, okay, make anything reasonable out of it. Also, rewriting equation and then putting the other collection of the words on it, it doesn't mean solution of any problem. Okay, when I said universes, okay, reality, it's going beyond of changing of vocabulary. You see, what Einstein was telling about Bohmian interpretation, it's better if you will read in Einstein yourself because he was not very nice with respect to the Bohmian interpretation. You know what he wrote, huh? No, he wrote that, okay, I'm not going to discuss trivialities. Yeah.
Okay, there are no more urgent questions. Let's thank again Slava.